and we know P loss conduction is nothing but I load square into R loss. So, what I load is known, what do we need to calculate? R loss. So, R loss should be 120 milliwatt divided by 1 ampere square, which is nothing but 120 milliohm. And this R loss is R DCR plus R on. Okay. So now you have two choices. Either you reduce R on and have a choose a bigger R DCR or other way around. So what do you prefer? Smaller R on or bigger R on? And while keeping the same R loss same. Bigger transistor for bigger R on? Oh, okay. Smaller R on, huh? Yeah. So, if you let us say out of 120, you say that I will keep R on 20 milliohm and RDCR 100 milliohm. So, 20 milliohm means your FET size should be big. What you will be losing here? The area and the switching losses, gate drive switching loss, because cap size will also be larger, gate cap. So, first you try to find the inductor with the smallest DCR, that is the first thing you should do. But if something is not available below, let us say 50 milliohm, then you do not have any choice. Huh? So, first we try to find the inductor with the smallest DCR possible. So, choosing smaller or lower R on will increase area and switching loss. Okay. Look for inductors with smallest possible RDCR. Okay. So, I am just choosing a number, let us say RDCR equal to 50 milliohm, which is quite realistic number. I mean, you can find lot of inductors with 50 milliohm. But when I say I want to have an inductor with 10 or 20 milliohm, then it may be difficult. If you are talking about micro Henry, then just 1, 2, 3 micro Henry. But if I, let us say you go inductor value goes maybe 0.47 or so, then 20, 25 milli is quite possible. I mean, think about if 1 micro Henry you can find 50 milliohm and you are using half of that. So, number of turns will also go half. So, your coil resistance has to reduce. So, the lower the inductor value is, smaller the resistance will be. If you are using obviously same material and if everything remains same. Okay. So, you will find the inductors in different way. You can find a 1 micro Henry inductor in a, let us say 2 mm by 2 mm package. And you can find a same value of inductor in 1 centimeter by 1 centimeter package also, because it all depends the thickness of coil and all those. So, when you go for power inductors, let us say inductor is supposed to carry tens of amp, then those inductors will be really big actually. I mean, that may be the biggest component on your board. But when you are talking of 1 amp kind of a current, then you can easily find in 2 millimeter by 2 millimeter, like or 2010. Kind of 2 by 1, 2 mm by 1 mm kind of package. So, So the size will be quite comparable to your capacitor, like tens of microfarad kind of caps. Okay, so now R1 is 70 milliohm. Okay, but so far we haven't calculated the losses. So for 70 milliohm, because in order to know the switching loss, gate drive switching loss, first you have to size your power FET. Unless you size it, you cannot, you can never find CV square F, because C should be known. The voltage is known. So once you know the C, and then from there you can relate your switching frequency and capacitor. So let's say with that particular C, I'm choosing a 10 megahertz, but you are seeing like your switching losses is bloating and going, let's say 50 milliwatt or so, then you have no choice but to reduce the switching frequency. Okay. So we need to size power FETs to have RDS on equal to 70 million, and this is considering that both RDS on of P and N same, but you can choose different as long as your efficiency numbers are met. Okay, so let's say I'm keeping the size of PMOS and NMOS same, and I know the mobility of PMOS is less, it may be 3 to 4 times less. So your RDS on of PMOS will be 3 to 4 times in that case. Okay, but it all depends what are the total losses. So if your PMOS is conducting, I mean, what are the condition where PMOS will be conducting for a longer time on an average? If your duty cycle is more than 50%, if your duty cycle is more than 50%, then high side FET or PMOS is conducting for longer time compared to NMOS. Okay, so if you apply that formula, D into R on plus 1 minus D into R on PM plus 1 minus D into R on N, then from there you can optimize actually if you know the duty cycle range. But if your duty cycle you are catering to is all the way from 10% to 90%, then you have to keep roughly the same RDS on for both FETs, then you don't have any choice. But if you know that you are always operating more than 50%, then you can choose your PMOS bigger compared to NMOS, because you want to optimize the total RDS on. So the R on total is 1 into R on P plus 1 minus D into R on N. Okay. So let's take an example. Let's say my D is 0.7. Okay. And if I keep R on equal to R on P equal to R on N equal to, let's say, same 70 milli ohm, then your so that's the one case. And so this is case 1, then your R on is nothing but 70 milliohm. Case 2, R on P is not equal to R on N. So let's say I'm keeping R on, I know that I'm operating at 0.7, which is higher side. So let's say I make it 10 milliohm less, let's say I make it 50 milliohm, and R on N equal to 90 milliohm. Okay. So what will be the total R on? D times, which is 0.7 into 50 milliohm plus 1 minus D into 90 milliohm, 35 milliohm plus 27, this comes 27, huh? How much is this? 62. So, that is less than 70 milliohm, okay. So, this is the one way you can try to optimize, but if you, I am operating, let us say, instead of D 0.7, I am operating, let us say, 0.3, 0.4, then I would like to keep RDS on of NMOS is smaller than PMOS. And while doing this optimization, you are keeping the area roughly same, but total RDS on is reducing because of the duty cycle actually, okay. So, you can do these optimizations in the design. So, for now I will just try to go with RDS on of P same as RDS on of N and 70 milliohm, okay. So, what is the first thing we need to know? The size. So, what is the formula for RDS on? Anybody remembers? What is the drain current in, okay, drain current is triode region or linear region, MOSFET drain current formula, mu C aux W by L, VGS minus VTH into VDS minus VDS square by 2, okay. So, for triode region or linear region, VDS is much, much small. So, VDS square by 2 is approaching 0. So, we can neglect that square term. So, your ID is nothing but mu C aux W by L VGS minus VTH . So, your RDS is, or let me just write RDS, RDS is delta VDS over delta ID. So, differentiate it and what you get? 1 over mu C aux W by L VGS minus VTH, okay. And this is nothing but your overdrive. So, if VTH is, let us say VDD is 1.8 volt, VTH is approximately 0.5 volt, then RDS will be 1 over mu C aux W by L 1.3, okay. Sorry, 1.8 minus, oh sorry, yeah. So, one thing I am not considering, since it is a very low RDS on, so the IR drop will be, so what you are considering when it is fully on, then what will be the VGS you are applying? So, in the PMOS you are applying, so VGS you are looking on the source side, okay, not on the drain side. The drain side will be slightly smaller because of higher drop. So, you always look for the higher side VGS, okay. But these devices are symmetric actually. It does not matter which side you are considering, source or drain, okay. It only depends on the potential you are applying. These standard CMOS devices, they are symmetric. You can make any of the side as a source or drain, it does not matter. So, which means RDS, and we are looking for RDS equal to 70 milli ohm. And what do we need to calculate here? W by L. Okay. So, W by L will be 1 over mu C aux 70 milli ohm multiplied by 1.3. So, this has to come from the process mu C aux. Anybody remembers the number from simulations? Have you calculated for minimum size? Mu C aux for PMOS and NMOS. They have to be different for N and P. So, mu C aux, how much? 70 microamp per volt square. Is this simulated or?
In the process sheet.
Process sheet it says, okay, let us assume that. So, let us say mu P C aux equal to 70 microamp per volt square. Okay. So, which means W by L of P, PMOS equal to 1 over 70 into 10 power minus 6 into 70 10 power minus 3 into 1.3. How much is this? So, 10 to the power 9 divided by 70 into 70 into 1.3. 1.6 into 10 power 5, correct? This is what you are getting? Yeah, it is fine, roughly approximately 1. So, this is your W by L, and L equal to, let us say, 180 nanometer. So, W should be, so what you are getting? 0.18 multiplied by 1.6, 288 into 10 power 5. Okay, 28.8 millimeter. Okay, so this is your width for minimum size L. 2.8 centimeter. How do you place this in your chip? So, you split it in fingers actually. You cannot choose a single finger, otherwise it will be looking like a stick, transistor. So, what you do? You connect very smaller transistors in parallel, smaller width. So, let us say you choose like 100 micron one unit. Okay, so your total number of fingers will be 28.8 millimeter divided by 100 micron, and that many fingers you have to connect in parallel. That is how you do in the layout actually, big transistors. You do not use single fingers. Okay.